Good morning, students. Today we will start with a new chapter, that is atoms, the atomic physics. In this chapter we'll study the following topics: Thomson atomic model, number second, scattering of alpha particles, number third, Rutherford's nuclear model of atom, number fourth, number fifth, the line spectra of the hydrogen atom, last, de Broglie explanation. In this chapter, we will study the following topics, that is Thomson's atomic model, scattering of alpha particles, the experiment performed by the Eschwiger and the E. Marsden, Rutherford's nuclear model of atom, Bohr's model of hydrogen atom, the line spectra of the hydrogen atom, de Broglie's explanation of Bohr's second postulate of quantization. These are the topics which we are going to study in this chapter. Now, first of all, we'll study the Thomson's atomic model. So we will study the different models of atom in this chapter. First, we will see the Dalton's atomic theory. In 1803, an English teacher, Dalton, he postulated that the matter is made up of, that is made up of minute particles called as atoms. Called as atoms, it comes from the Greek word atomos, which means uncut or indivisible. It means that the matter is made up of the small minute particles which are known as the atoms. Atoms means ki which can't be further divided. The smallest particle which constitutes the whole matter, that is the atom. But later, the discovery of the radioactivity or other subatomic particles, like discovery of the electron made by the J.J. Thomson in 1897, this theory was rejected. This was regarded. It means from that, it was proposed that atom is not the basic constituent of the atom. Rather, atom is made up of some other particles. Now, the first structure of atom was proposed by J.J. Thomson. Now, in 1897, the experiment on electric discharge through gases carried out by the J.J. Thomson, one of the English physicists who carried the experiment of the electric discharge through gases, whereby he revealed that the atoms, they contain the negatively charged constituents called the electrons. Electrons, and these negatively charged electrons are identical of all the atoms of different elements. They are same. Their shape is same. Their size will be same. These negatively constituents. Since atom as a whole is electrically neutral, he proposed that there must be some positive charge that is also contained by the atom, since the atom is electrically neutral. So therefore, what will be the arrangement of this positive charge and the negatively charged electrons in an atom. He proposed a model, J.J. Thomson, in 1987. He proposed a model which is known as the Thomson's atomic model, or this is also known as the Plum-Pudding model. According to this model, an atom is positively charged sphere of size that is for minus 10 meter and the electrons negatively charged electrons are embedded in it. The positive charge and whole mass of the atom is distributed uniformly throughout the sphere. So this is the Plum-Pudding model as proposed by the J.J. Thomson in 90. Because after the discovery of electron in 1897, he proposed a model. In 1898, he proposed a model which is known as the Thomson's model of atom or Plum-Pudding model. An atom is positively charged sphere of size or radius, we can say, 10 is for minus 10 meter. And the negatively charged electrons are embedded in it. The positive charge and the whole mass of the atom is distributed uniformly throughout this sphere, which is the charged sphere, which is actually positively charged sphere. So diagrammatically, we can show this. Now pictorially, we can represent the Thomson's model. This is a sphere, which is actually the positive charged sphere in which the positive charge of the atom is uniformly distributed. And in this positively charged sphere, the electrons are embedded in it as proposed by the J.J. Thomson, which I have shown by the violet color. These are the electrons which are embedded in it. Although this model of atom could explain the large phenomena like emission of electrons from the atoms, but there are shortcomings of this model. What are those? As I told you that Thomson's model, it could explain the certain phenomena which was observed from the atoms, like the emission of electrons from the atoms, yeah, other phenomena, but it could not explain the spectra of atoms. In the early of the 19th century, it was established that each atom is characterized by its spectrum. The simplest atom was the hydrogen, and the hydrogen has its own emission spectra or absorption spectra. It emits some definite wavelength, definite radiations of particular wavelength. Thomson's model, it fails to explain the spectra of the atoms. Even of the simplest atom, hydrogen, it could not explain the spectra of this atom. Number one. Number two, it could not explain the scattering of alpha particle. at that time, on the suggestion of the Rutherford, two of his collaborators, two of his associates, they performed an experiment that is known as the scattering of alpha particles, alpha scattering experiment. That alpha scattering experiment couldn't be explained by using the Thomson's atomic model. So therefore, keeping these things in view, this model was rejected. This was discarded. Now, we will study the scattering of alpha particles. Now, at the suggestions of the Ernest Rutherford, in 1911, H. Giger, Hannes Giger, and E. Marsden, they performed an experiment by bombarding alpha particles on a gold foil. The schematic view of the experiment is shown in the figure. This is the lead box. Here, this is the S. Suppose this S is the source of which I have shown by the yellow dot. This is the source of alpha particles, radioactive source, which emits the alpha particles. And this source of alpha particle is placed in a lead box with a narrow opening. The alpha particles, which are coming out from the source, their passage is made through the, these are the lead bricks, which acts as a collimator. The alpha particles, which are emitted by the source at that time, which was used, that is the bismuth 214. Atomic mass and 83 as atomic number. This was the radioactive source, which was the source of the alpha particle, which emits the alpha particle that was used in this experiment as performed by the Giger and Marsden. So this beam of alpha particles, they are collimated with the help of the collimator, which is made up of lead bricks, and these alpha particles are allowed to pass through this. And a well collimated and narrow beam of alpha particles, they are allowed to fall on the gold foil. Here, this is the gold foil here. Of thickness, the thickness of the gold foil was 2×10⁻⁷ meters. On a very thin gold foil, these alpha particles was allowed to fall on the well collimated beam, was allowed to fall on the gold foil, whose thickness was 2×10⁻⁷ meters. And the beam of this alpha, well collimated beam of alpha particle, get scattered by this gold foil. And these are detected by the detector. This is the detector which I have shown by the violet color. And this detector, it consists of a zinc sulfide screen. This is actually a zinc sulfide screen. These are received by the, and this zinc, this is along with a microscope, which is rotable. The alpha particles, these scattered alpha particles were detected by a detector, movable detector, which consists of a zinc sulfide screen and a microscope. Why sulfide screen is used? Because when the scattered alpha particles, when they strike this zinc sulfide screen, they produce flashes in it, or we can say they produce scintillations. And these scintillations are viewed through the microscope and are counted. So this was the experiment as performed by the H. Giger and E. Marsden. That is why this is also known as the Giger-Marsden experiment, or alpha particle scattering experiment. This is the experiment. So these, what was the observations in this experiment? So this is the experimental setup which was used in the alpha scattering experiment. Again, I will repeat. Source of alpha particle, yani radioactive source, that is placed in a lead box with a narrow opening, and the alpha particles, their passage is made to pass, they are allowed to pass through these lead bricks, which produces a narrow, well-collimated narrow beam of alpha particles, and this narrow, well-collimated beam of alpha particles are allowed to fall on the thin gold foil whose thickness is 2 × 10⁻⁷ meter. And when this gold foil, it scatters this beam of alpha particles into different directions, it scatters it, and the scattered alpha particles are detected by a rotable detector, which consists of a zinc sulfide screen and a microscope. When these alpha particles, when they strike the zinc sulfide screen, they produce scintillations in it. In other words, we can say they produce the small light flashes in the screen, and with the help of the microscope, they are viewed through the microscope, and we count them. Now, let us see what are the observations. We will write down the observations in this experiment. These are the observations made by the H. Giger and the Marsden in their experiment, which were performed on the suggestion of Ernest Rutherford. What was the observation is that most of the alpha particles pass through the gold foil undeviated. Even the beam of the alpha particles, when it was allowed to fall on the gold foil, as we have seen in the experiment, the gold foil, it scatters this beam of alpha particles. And during the observations, because they have detected this scattered beam of alpha particles with the help of a detector which consists of a zinc sulfide screen and the rotable and a microscope. So they have observed that most of the alpha particles pass through the gold foil undeviated. Almost most of the alpha particles, they don't have any deviation by the gold foil. And second observation, that only about 0.14% of the incident alpha particle. Now see, this is a very small percent fraction of the total incident alpha particle that is scattered by more than 1 degree. That is scattered by more than 1 degree or of the order of 1 degree. And third, about 1 alpha particle in every 8,000 alpha particles. If 8,000 alpha particles are made to incident on the gold foil, on what of these 8,000 alpha particles, what they observe that only one alpha particles get scattered by more than 90 degree. More than 90 degrees. These were the observations made by the Giger and the Marsden in their experiments they have performed. Now, what was the conclusion? Now, Rutherford, on the basis of these observations, he concludes that from the observation number first, that most of the space of the atom is empty. Why? Because in this experiment, the thickness of the gold foil is made very thin. As I have told you that the thickness of the gold foil is 2.0 × 10⁻⁷ meter. This was the thickness of the gold foil. Now, we have seen that from the observation is that most of the alpha particles, while passing through this thin gold foil, they remain undeviated. They remain undeviated. From this, Rutherford concludes that the most of the space in an atom is empty. Why? He says that when the alpha particles, when it passes through the gold foil, he assumes that actually, since the thickness of the gold foil is made very thin. It is very thin. Therefore, the scattering of the alpha pi, he actually, it is the assumption made by the Rutherford that the scattering of the alpha particle is only due to one atom. It collides, it interacts only with one atom of the foil, of the gold foil, and that one atom is, that produces the scattering in the alpha particles. So therefore, from this assumption, he concludes on the basis of this observation, from this observation, he concludes that most of the space in an atom is empty. Most of the space in an atom is empty. Conclusion. That most of the space in an atom, in the atom, is empty. This was the conclusion. From the observation number second and third, these are the observed, this was the conclusion from the observation number first and second. Here I should write conclusion. From the observation number one and second, where they have found that most of the alpha particles remain undeviated while passing through the gold foil, and only 0.14% of the total incident alpha particles, out of the total incident alpha particles, only 0.14% get deviated through 1 degree. So from these two observations, Rutherford concluded that the most of the space in the atom is empty. And in the observation number three, that is about one alpha particle in every 8,000 alpha particles is scattered by more than 90 degrees. From this observation, he concluded that the entire positive charge of an atom and the whole of its mass is contained in a small volume of the atom that is known as the nucleus. Rutherford call it as nucleus. Thus, this was the conclusion is made by the Rutherford from the Giger-Mersenne's experiment. Conclusion number one, that is most of the space in an atom is empty. And conclusion number two, that entire, because we know that from the Thomson method, that atom is made up of some positive and negatively charged particles. And as per the Thomson, the positive charge was distributed over the whole space of the atom. But Rutherford rejected that because that theory was, that model was unable to explain the, as I told you there, this alpha scattering experiment. Why? Because it could not explain that model could not explain the observation number third, that only about one of the alpha particle out of 800 incident alpha particles was deviated through more than 90 degrees. That was not explained by that model. That is why that was rejected. And this was explained on the basis of that observation. The Rutherford concluded that the entire positive charge of an atom that is not distributed over the whole space of the atom. Rather, says that it is that the positive charge of an atom and whole of its mass and almost whole of its mass is contained in a small volume. That small portion of the atom which contains whole positive charge of the atom and almost all of its mass, whole of its mass, that small portion of the atom is known as the nucleus, is called the nucleus. So on the basis of these observations and what Rutherford concluded, on the basis of these, he proposed a new model of atom that is known as Rutherford's nuclear model of atom. Rutherford's or Rutherford's planetary model of atoms. On the basis of these observations and what Rutherford concluded, he proposed a new model of atom, which is known as the Rutherford's nuclear model of atom, or sometimes this is also known as the planetary model of atom. According to this model of atom, an atom is electrically neutral sphere. The atom is spherical in shape, consists of a very small and massive central core, which is known as the nucleus, which contains the entire positive charge of the atom and almost the whole of its mass. The size of the nucleus of the is very small, which is of the order of 10⁻⁵ meter to 10⁻⁴ meter. 10⁻⁴ meter, as compared to the size of the atom, which is of the order of 10⁻⁰ meter. Thus, from this, we can say that the size of atom is almost 10,000 times the larger than the atom, or 100,000 times larger than the nucleus. From this, we can say that the size of nucleus, as proposed by the Rutherford, that the size of nucleus is in this range, 10⁻⁵ meter to 10⁻⁴ meter, as compared to the size of atom, which is of the order of 10⁻⁰ meter. It means that the size of atom is 10,000 times larger than, or 100,000 times larger than the size of the nucleus. And third, the nucleus is surrounded by a suitable number of electrons, so that their total negative, because these electrons are negatively charged particle, and as he has claimed, that is an electrically neutral sphere. So what he claims, that nucleus is surrounded by the suitable number of electrons, so that their total negative charge is equal to the negative positive charge of the nucleus. Fourth, the nucleus is surrounded by the suitable number of negatively charged electrons, so that their total negative charge is equal to the positive charge of the nucleus. And these negatively charged electrons are revolving around the nucleus in various orbits, just like planets are revolving around the sun. These electrons, they are revolving around the nucleus in an atom, in the same way, just like the planets are doing around the, just like they are revolving around the sun. Now, we know that from the classical theory that when a particle is moving in a, when it follows a circular path, so in moving a circular path, it requires a force, which is known as the centripetal force. Any particle which is moving, which is following a circular path, which is moving in a curved path, in order to move in a curved path, it requires a force which is known as the centripetal force. So when the Rutherford says that the electrons, they are revolving in circular orbits, they are revolving in around the nucleus, just like the planets are revolving around the sun. So these orbits, these circular orbits, in order to move in a circular orbit, these electrons require centripetal force. And Rutherford, in the fifth, he says that the centripetal force that is required for their revolution, that is provided by the electrostatic attraction between the electrons and the nucleus. Because as per that, there is a Coulomb interaction between these electrons, because they are negatively charged, and nucleus, it is a positively charged. So they interact, there will be a Coulomb interaction, and this attraction, force of attraction, because they are opposite, the nature of the charge is opposite, therefore they will attract. That attractive force, that will provide the necessary centripetal force, which they require for their revolution around the sun. So this was the model as proposed by the model. Or yahi model aaj jo hum jis jo hum ने आज एक्सेप्ट किया है, जो कि एक्चुअली इस वक्त माना जाता है मॉडल ऑफ द एटम, दैट इज द रदरफोर्ड्स मॉडल ऑफ एटम. एन एटम, इट कंसिस्ट्स ऑफ ए स्मॉल cold central core, which contains whole of its entire of its positive charges and almost all of its mass, that is known as the nucleus, and electrons are revolving around this. So this was the Rutherford's model of atom. Now using the model of atom, using this model of atom, Rutherford explains the scattering of Rutherford uses this model of atom, which he has proposed, and he explains the scattering of the alpha particles by the gold fire. Now, impact parameter. Now, the scattering of the alpha, as I told you, Rutherford assumed that when the alpha particles, when they are made to incident on the gold foil, since the thickness of the gold foil was very small, that was of the order of 10.0 into 10 to the power minus 7, he assumes that when the alpha particle is passing through the gold foil, the scattering produced in the alpha particle is due to the impact with one of the atoms of the gold foil. It was the assumption made by the. Now that trajectory, the path followed by the different alpha particles, which were when the beam of alpha particle were made to incident on this, the trajectory followed by the when there was an impact of this of these alpha particles with the atom of the gold foil, the trajectories of the different alpha particles was different. So he proposed that the trajectory followed by the different alpha particle, it depends upon the impact parameter. Now, first of all, let us see what is impact parameter. It is the distance, it is defined as the perpendicular distance of the initial velocity vector of the alpha particle from the center of the nucleus. It is usually denoted by B. When the beam of alpha particles are made to incident, the initial velocity vector before the impact of the alpha particle and the atom of the gold foil, before impact, the direction of the velocity, the initial direction of the velocity like this. For example, the alpha particle, which I have shown by the yellow line, the initial velocity direction is shown by the dotted line. So since as it is approaching to the nucleus of the atom, it interacts because of the impact between the alpha particle and the nucleus, this gets deviated. What is the impact parameter? Impact parameter, it is the perpendicular distance of this initial velocity vector from the center of the nucleus. And for different different alpha particles in the beam, they have different impact parameters. If we talk of number one, the impact parameter is zero. And as we go away from this line number one, the impact parameter of the alpha particles, it increases. Thus, we can say in the beam of alpha particles, there is a distribution of impact parameters. For this, they have different impact parameters. There is a different distribution of impact parameters. And the scattering of the alpha particle, it depends upon the trajectory followed by the alpha particle. It depends upon its impact parameter, what was the suggested by the Rutherford. So, and he analytically determined the relationship between the impact parameter and the angle of scattering. What is angle of scattering? Yeah, scattering angle, we can say. What is scattering angle? Scattering angle is the scattered beam, the angle which the scattered beam this yellow one makes with its initial direction, this theta. This is known as the scattering angle. The angle which the scattered alpha particle makes with its initial direction. That is known as the scattering angle.
and Rutherford analytically determined the relationship between the impact parameter and the angle, scattering angle. What was that?
B is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught z e square cot theta by 2 divided by
e. This is the relationship between which Rutherford found analytically between the impact parameter and angle of scattering. And this here z, it is the atomic number of the atom with which the alpha particle is interacting, is the charge of electron. And 4 pi epsilon r is the constant, theta is the scattering angle, and E, it is the energy of the alpha incident alpha particles. Now, for large values of the impact parameter B, for example, this white line, so there is no deviation. When the impact parameter is very large, when the impact parameter is very large, for a given energy of the alpha particle, keeping the energy, suppose this, the energy of all these alpha particles will be fixed, let us suppose that is E. Now, but the there is a distribution of impact parameters. For this, it is zero. For this, there is some value. For this, it increases. As you go away from the nucleus, the value of the impact parameter, it increases. Now, when the impact parameter is large, even the impact parameter B is large, therefore this must be large, scattering cot of theta by 2, it should be large, implies that theta by 2 is small. Now, as the, from this it is clear that as the impact parameter increases, the value of the cot theta by 2, where theta is the scattering angle, that means this should be large, because when this is large for a given energy of the alpha particles. So therefore, this is large only when the angle, when the value of the angle in the cosine function is small. Therefore, theta by 2 is small. Now, the alpha particle, which is very, very far from the nucleus, this is almost zero. This B is as far as the dimensions, nuclear dimensions considered, we can say the B is infinite. When B is infinite, so therefore we can conclude that theta is almost zero. Then at that time, angle of scattering is zero. That means there will be no scattering to these particles which are far from the nucleus. Or similarly, we can say for those in which the B is, if B is large, if B is small, B is small, then cot theta by 2 must be small, is small. The cosine, the value of the cosine function is very small when the angle in the cosine function is large. It means theta by 2 must be large. Thus, from this, we can conclude that as the impact parameter of the alpha particles decreases, the angle of scattering that increases, the angle of scattering, and that decides the nature of the path, and again, we can say trajectory of the alpha particles. Similarly, if we talk of the line number I have marked as 1, the impact parameter is 0. The impact parameter for this is 0. B is equal to 0. We can say cot of theta by 2 must be 0, because 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught is not 0, atomic number of the atom is not 0, E is not 0, and energy of the alpha particle which is made to incident on the gold foil, that is also not 0. So therefore, we can say if this is 0, then this factor must be equal to 0. Or we can say theta by 2 is equal to, that is 90 degrees. This must be, because then the angle where the theta function becomes zero, cosine cot function becomes zero, the value of the angle must be 90. Or theta, the angle of scattering is 180. That means the alpha particle for which the impact parameter is zero, then the angle of scattering is 180 degrees. Means it retraces this path.
It follows the same path in which it was going. It was traveling and it was approaching the nucleus. It follows the same path but in opposite direction, like this. But it retraces its path. So thus, we can say it is the impact parameter which decides the trajectory of the alpha particles. Now, more will be the impact meter, less will be the angle of scattering, and hence, almost the particles, the alpha particles, which are far from the nucleus, their impact parameter is very large, therefore they are scattering almost negligible. And the particles, which are very, very close to the nucleus, as they are approaching to the nucleus, because of the repulsive force of these electrons, they get scattered. And now it is the dependence upon the impact parameter, which decides their trajectory. Less will be the B, less will be the impact parameter, more will be the angle of scattering. Now, in the next topic, inshallah, we will see the distance of closest approach. Thank you. We will see in that topic how Rutherford calculates the approximate size of the nucleus. That will be done in the next chapter. Best of luck.